Ahankara chittani naham nacha shrutra juvhe nacha ghranu netre nacha bhoma bhumi nate jo nabayu chitananda rupa shivaham name desho ragau name lobha moho madona iva mena iva matam Manamatanabhavam, no dharmo, no charto, no kamo, no moksham, Chidananda rupa shivaham, shivaham. From six stanzas of Nirvana by Shankara. I am not mind, intellect, thought or ego, not hearing, taste, smelling or sight, not ether or earth, fire or air. I am the soul of knowledge and bliss. I am Shiva, I am Shiva. I have no aversion or clinging, greed or delusion, no envy or pride, duty or purpose, no desire, no freedom. I am the soul of knowledge and bliss. I am Shiva. I am Shiva. In this prayer, Shankara negated our minds, bodies, senses, and reminded us our true nature. By nature, we are divine. We are the Atma. Existence absolute, knowledge absolute, bliss absolute. It is easy to say, but very difficult to practice. I remember in our Vedanta class, we are talking about higher philosophy. Then our teacher teased us, you are all grihastha. Grihastha means householders. We said, no Swami, we are monks. No, you are all householders. Then he explained to us, do you know who is the householder? Those who live in a body. This body, my body is my house, your body is your house. This house is very external. This is the house we live. So he was reminding us, your body is your house and you live there. But if you live in the spirit, in the Atman, then you are not a householder. What a beautiful lesson we got from him. Sometimes we say that I am in hell, I am in heaven. This heaven and hell are not outside, it is in the mind. You can make your life heaven, you can make your life hell. It depends upon your karma, your thinking. We experience this heaven and hell every day. These are all in the mind. I remember another incident. A great Swami who was a Vedantin fell down from his bed. He was meditating on the bed and in the mosquito curtain, and he was so absorbed in meditation that when he was bowing to the Lord, he did not remember where he was. He just fell. and his collarbone broke. We took him to the hospital. When he came back from the hospital, I asked him, "Swami, how are you?" He says, "I'm all right." Then I asked, "Do you have still pain?" He did not like it. I am a young monk reminding a great monk, reminding his body. He did not like it. He asked me, "Are you all right?" I said, "Yes." "No, you are not all right." I said, "Yes, I am all right. My health is okay." "No, your health is not okay." Then he explained this. No human body is perfect. You may think you are okay. If I send you a doctor, he will find somewhere, in some place, in some organs are not working right. Hey, you are here, nearly 60 people are here. Just ask yourself, are you perfect? Your body is perfect? No. Even if 15, 20 years young person, ask, "No, somewhere I have something wrong." I got a great lesson. Never be proud of your body. It is not perfect. So is the mind. Swami Vivekananda differentiated between the sane and the insane. The sane has a control over his emotions, and the insane does not have control. That is the only difference. We find so many health food stores, health clubs in town. People go there. But we do not find too many mental food stores or mental health club in town. There may be some yoga centers, but they teach hatha yoga, how to keep the body fit. That's all. Do you know, it shows that what we are interested. We want nice body. We do not take care of our minds properly. Our minds are very much neglected. I remember there was in 70s a big yogi announced, "All religions are busy to take care of the poor people, and nobody is taking care of the rich people. They are so much neglected, I take care of them." I smiled. Rich people are very neglected, you see. For that reason, I have 91 Rolls Royce. Later on, he was in jail, he died in hell. If somebody asks you that you have a healthy body and sick mind, with sick mind, or a healthy mind with a sick body, which one do you prefer? I hope most people will ask the second one. I want a healthy mind. The body may not be working right. Our doctors are there, they will fix it. But a healthy mind, a strong mind, pure mind, spiritual mind, are very vital. Do you know why? Because we experience happiness and misery through the mind. We are born in this world to enjoy happiness, joy, peace, bliss. That does not depend upon the body. It comes through the mind. Sometimes I ask people who come for interview, I said, "You know, I love to give you some instruction, but you will have to obey me. You give food to your body 3 times a day, breakfast, lunch, dinner. How many times do you feed your mind? Please see twice a day. You should have a shrine, your meditation corner in your house. Morning and evening, you must sit. Habit will form character. Transformation comes through repetition of practice. When I was in Hollywood, my senior Swami of Prabhavananda, he insisted every monk and nun should come to the shrine and sit 3 times a day, 3 hours. Morning 7 to 8, noon 12 to 1, and evening 6 to 7. Compulsory. You must feed your mind. You must give some good spiritual food so that you will be healthy. As the body becomes dirty by dirt and some other external objects, similarly the mind becomes dirty by 3 ways. The Vedanta teacher says, first mala dosha, gross dirty dirt. Do you know how does the gross dirt goes to the mind? Sinful action, murdering, adultery. All these things directly go to the mind and make a big black patch mark on the mind. Straight it goes. When you do a sinful action or something very wrong, immediately you go and stand in front of the mirror, you will see your eyes covered with that glossiness, that brightness will go away. Dull eyes, bad looking face, you will see. How to get rid of it? Shastriya karma. Through holy good action, which is enjoined by the scriptures, that will counteract it. Gross things, you need some gross remedy. Second, vikshepa dosha. Restlessness of the mind. That one is subtle. How to get rid of it? As I said, daily meditation, prayer. Reading holy books. Shagun nirgun upasana. That is the way your restlessness of your mind will diminish. Third, avaran dosha. Everybody's mind, there is a veil of ignorance. That goes away by nirvikalpa samadhi. That one is the highest spiritual experience. That experience will give you the wisdom, knowledge, experience that you are Brahman, you are one with God. We see our bodies, our head, but we do not see our minds, very subtle. But we know that we have a mind. How do you know that you have a mind? Thousands of years ago, the Rishi of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, Kama, Sankalpa, Vichikitsa, Shraddha, Ashraddha, Dhriti, Adhriti, Ri, Vi, Dhi, Sarvam, Manaiva. This is the way human beings detect the activities of their minds. Kama, desires. You just close your eyes, you can see how your mind is desiring so many objects in this world. Sankalpa, resolution, vichikitsa, doubt, faith, lack of faith, fortitude, lack of fortitude, fear, shame, all these things indicate that you have a mind. But you do not see it. You see the waves which are rising in your minds. We see through the mind, we hear through the mind. Sometimes you are very much absorbed with something, I asked a question, I did not hear. Your eyes are seeing something, but I did not see. My mind was not there, I was absent-minded. Really we see, we hear, we experience through the mind. Mind is the king of the all sense organs. Mind, he is by nature pure, transparent. but we pollute it. I went to see a candle factory in Portland. One of our devotees wanted to show me. Uncle, I'll have to see how they make the candle. In the store, I saw paraffin slab, big slab, transparent. And they're taking those slabs of paraffin and put into a cauldron. And then they added color, blue, red, yellow. Different cauldron had different color. That color become one with the paraffin. And then they have an assembly line, all these candles, 1 inch, 2 inch, or several inches, all these candles with this, with the thread, all wick, all are coming in a procession. I have never seen candle factory in India. Here I saw. What I want to tell you, that whatever color you add with that particular paraffin, it will take that color. Ramakrishna gave a beautiful example. Man dhupa gharer kapur, je rongi chubbe, shei rongi pabe. Human mind is just like the cloth of a washerman's house. The washerman has many dyes in different tubs. If you want yellow, see, he will dip your cloth into yellow. Blue, he will dip your cloth into blue. Whatever color you want, the washerman will give you that color. So if you want a spiritual color, you'll have to dip your mind into spirituality. Worldly color, you know how to dip it. You don't need any teachers. Vyasa, the great commentator of the Yoga Sutra, mentioned prakha rupam hi chitta sattam rajastamobhyam sang srishtam vasharja vishaya priyam bhavati. Human mind comes from pure sattva guna. It is really transparent, it is really clean. I have seen in Yosemite National Forest in Northern California, that is perhaps one of the best scenic spots in the United States of America. Virgin natural beauty. Those trees, that water. I have never seen such transparent water. You can shave your face. The water just like a mirror. So clean. Melted ice, you can understand. Who pollutes it? We. All kinds of cans and food and, you know, those who go there for picnic. We spoil that beautiful atmosphere, environment. So human mind is really pure, clean, transparent, good. We pollute it by rajaguna and tamaguna. Desire, greed, tamaguna, dullness, cruelty, inertia. We are constantly polluting our minds. When I was in Los Angeles, sometimes I would go to the Griffith Observatory. It is very close to the Vedanta Center. I cannot tell you that after rain, if you go there at 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, it is really the city of angels. The whole basin of Los Angeles is so beautiful. From the Mulholland Drive also, you can see it. I saw from both places. It is so beautiful. But daytime, you will get eye irritation. Millions of cars, their fumes, exhaustion, ruin that city. Who pollutes it? We. We are responsible. You know, sometimes this nature also gives lessons to us. We understand. I do not pollute your mind, you do not pollute my mind. It is you, it is me. We pollute our minds. So when this mind is tinged, covered, associated with rajas and tamas, it becomes extrovert, goes outside, runs to the shopping mall. It goes to the riverboat gambling. All the mind goes outside. Mind is the king of the senses. Shankara raised this question, Jitam jagat kena manohi jena. Who has conquered the world? He who has conquered the mind. That is a beautiful answer. Patanjali also analyzed five states of the mind. Five states of the mind. First is kshipta, restless mind, dull mind, and sometimes mind becomes calm, again becomes restless. These three states of the mind go downward. And two other states, ekagro and niruddha, one-pointed, concentrated, and collected, absorbed mind. These two states will take you toward God. This mind is restless. How to deal with this mind? Mind is just like the stock market. Roller coaster continuously moving. I still remember one lady came and said, Swami, my mind is connected with my stocks. Every morning I open the computer and see my stocks. The day stock is up, I am happy. The day stock is down, I am unhappy. I cannot help it. Just remember, if your mind is connected with money, what happens? Same thing, enjoyment. The day you feel good, you are happy. The day you don't feel good, you are unhappy. So this is the position of the average human being in this world. How to deal with this mind? Krishna told Arjuna, Kamaesho krodhesho rajaguna samudbhava mahasana mahapapma vidhi enam iyo vairinam. You are looking for enemies? I know two enemies within you. Lust and greed. They are terrible enemies. You cannot satisfy them. Kill them mercilessly, Arjuna. You cannot kill those enemies through arms and ammunition, through atom bomb. You cannot kill them. Arjuna, you might have a bow and the Gandiva and all these powerful divine weapons. You cannot kill them. Then he told in the 16th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Trividam narakasidam dharam nashanamatmana. I am cautioning you, there are three gates of hell. Kama, krodha, lobha, lust, anger and greed. These are the three gates of hell. When you feel those things, you remember, you are moving toward the hell. Stop it. So that you may not suffer, you may not get that hellfire. Then Arjuna was very much disturbed. O Krishna, then what is the way? You know, chanchalanghi manakrishna pramathi balavad dhiram. This mind is very restless. It is easy to control the wind. But I feel it is very, very difficult to control this restless mind. Show me the way. You are God in human form. Arjuna, Krishna gave only two remedies. Abhyasena tu kunteya vairagyena jagrichyate. Asamshaya mahabhavo. I agree with you wholeheartedly. Undoubtedly this mind is restless. But there are only two ways you can control it. Repetition of practice and detachment. Patanjali, the father of yoga psychology, mentioned also these two words. Abhyasa vairagyabhyam tan nirodha. Patanjali says you can control your mind only through these two ways. By repetition of practice and detachment, non-attachment. I gave many lectures on the mind here. Today I want to tell you how different Upanishads describe the function and the power of the mind. The ancient sages minutely studied the mind and left their findings for us. The Amritabindu Upanishad says, Manohi dividam proktam shuddham cha ashuddham evacha ashuddham kama sankalpam shuddham kama vivurjitam manaiva manushyanam karanam bandhamokshayoho bandhaya vishayasaktam muktam nirvishayam smritam. The mind is chiefly spoken of two kinds, pure and impure. The impure is possessed with desire and the pure is devoid of desire. It is indeed the mind that is the cause of men's bondage and liberation. The mind that is attached to sense objects leads to bondage. While dissociated from the sense objects, it tends to lead to liberation. Very clear. We don't need any commentary to understand these two verses of the Amritabindu Upanishad. Pure mind, impure mind. How does the mind get impure? When it is connected with the sense objects. When does the mind become pure? When it is dissociated from the sense objects. Liberation and bondage are all in the mind. That is the reason Sri Ramakrishna used to ask his devotees to say, that I am Shiva. I am not a sinner. The person who harps when the Brahma says, sir, we are sinners. The people, those who harp that I am a sinner, that person becomes sinner. The person says that I am Shiva, he becomes Shiva. Whatever you think that you will be. So this Upanishad tells us that if you really want to control your mind, practice meditation. In India, how they make butter. Sometimes some people churn the milk and make butter. Some in our part of the country, they used to boil the milk and settle it overnight. And that becomes yogurt. They put in an earthen jar and here is a bamboo. In village there is no electricity. Here is a bamboo rod, crossway, they churn it. That is the way the whole yogurt will be churned and the top will be butter and then will be buttermilk, lower part. That is the way in our village they used to make butter. So what is the churning rod? Mind. So continuously if you churn this mind, then the first portion, the fine portion, will come up. The churning is called meditation. Churn your mind. You know, sometimes I see these Upanishads tell us very practical lessons. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, I am Atma Brahma. This Atman is Brahman. This Brahman pervades in the body, mind, senses, intellect, everywhere. Jathakari, jathachari, tatha bhavuti. Whatever you do, whatever you think, that you will be. If you will think holy thoughts, you will be holy. If you think unholy thoughts, you will be unholy. Do you know kamo mayu vayam purusha? These human beings you see around you, do you know what? Full of desires. Vasana pushyati bapuhu. If you have no desires, your body will drop, fall off, fall apart. It is the desire which is the preservation of the body. You will not feel to get up from your bed if you do not have desire. Why should I get up? All incentive comes from desire. So this Upanishad tells us, when desire comes, resolution comes. When resolution comes, action comes. When action comes, the result of action comes. You have decided that I shall go to Vedanta temple. After breakfast, you got ready, dressed yourself, took the car from the garage, drove to the Vedanta temple, and now listening to the lecture on the mind. All these things came from your thoughts. If you would not resolve that I would not go to Vedanta temple, you would not come here. Sir, is there any way out? Then this rishi of the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad tells us, how many desires do you have? Oh sir, millions, hundreds, thousands. Every day I watch my mind, I see how many desires arises. How many desires arise in the mind every day, I watch. Then the rishi said, actually you have only three desires. Putrishana, vittishana, lokishana, sarvevishana eva bhavataha. Desire for progeny. Children, sex, desire for money, wealth, and desire for name and fame. These are the three desires are controlling this whole world. Your car desires or home desires are all included in the money desire. When the person becomes free from desire, devoid of desire, that mortal becomes immortal. He attains Brahman in this world. If you have no desire, do you know what will happen? You will go into samadhi. You will be one with God right now. Just see, whole thing is in desire. This sage, again, the king was asking Jagavalko, we have desires, no doubt, when we shall depart from this world, what will go with us? I am saving money in the bank, making trust for my wife and children. Some people are planning all the time, money, 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 you know. What will go with you? Only three things will go with you. Your body will go to Valhalla, no doubt. Crematorium, and your mind, the subtle body, will carry three things. That is your possession. Vidya, your knowledge, wisdom, which you have attained, gained in this life. Karma, good and bad action, what you have done in this life, they will go with you. And purva prajna, your past samskaras. These three things will go with you. No bank balance, no jewelry, no home, no car. It is 100% certain. Then in the Chandogya Upanishad, a young boy came to his father and inquired about Atman. Then the father says, Annamaya Manaha. Father, could you tell me which is this mind? I have so much trouble, I have so much ego. I remember I had a student, she used to complain, Swami, I have too much ego. Then I told her, are you the Miss Universe? No, Swami. Do you have millions of dollars? No, Swami. Do you have any PhD degrees? No, Swami. Then what do you have? Sometimes people become proud if you have fantastic beauty or a lot of money or a lot of learning, you become proud. You are right, Swami. Yeah, think of that. What do you have? And I am proud. Ego. So this boy had tremendous ego about his learning. So his father was asking, his father said, Annamaya Manaha. This human mind comes from food. He could not believe it. The food we buy from Shlok's groceries, that makes my food. How come? Shambhara Swami is crazy. The father said, Shorosho kala, Shorosho kala ayam purusha. This Atman has 16 limbs. Look, my boy, don't eat any food for the next 16 days, but drink plenty of water. You will not die. No food. Then the father, after a few days, asked the question, I taught you the Vedas. Could you recite them? He could not recite. I don't remember. I feel weak. My brain is not working. Then the father said, go, have some meal. Have some good food, then come back. He went, ate food. Now you recite the Vedas. So he recited. Did I not tell you? The mind comes from the food. Then he said, the food which you eat, it has three parts. The finest part of the food makes your mind. The middle part of the food makes your flesh, blood, bone, marrow, all those things. And the gross part of the food goes away from the system. You know, sometimes when I read these Upanishads, I see in ancient time how people explode this human system. In Chandogya Upanishad, we find another story. Narada went to Sanat Kumara, a great sage, and said, I know 64 branches of learning. Aham Shochami. Still I am submerged in grief. Then the teacher gave lessons. Mind is Brahman. Mind is very powerful. When a man thinks in his mind that he would read the sacred hymns, performs actions. When he decides that I should have sons and cattle, he gets whatever he desires. He who meditates on mind as Brahman can reach as far as mind reaches. Mind, meditate on mind as Brahman. Then, of course, he went on and on. Is there anything higher than the mind? Yes. Is there any higher than that? In this way, after, I think, 21 lessons, he understood the highest thing is Bhuma. Vastness, Brahman. Infinite is Brahman. So he reached there, to the infinite. Now, finally, this teacher gave the lesson to Narada. That verse quite often I quote in my lectures. Ahara Shuddhau Satya Shuddhi Satya Shuddhau Dhruva Smriti Smriti Lambe Sarva Granthi Nam Vipramuksha. Ahar, if you gather good things through your senses, your mind is bound to be pure. And what is the sign of a pure mind? Do you know what is the sign of a pure mind? You will get constant recollectedness of God. And when you have that constant recollectedness of God, you will be illumined. You will be free forever. Whole thing is in the mind. The sage of the Katha Upanishad explained this mind through an analogy. Listen, young man, Nachiketa, this body is a chariot. And the passenger in this body is the Atman. And your buddhi, intellect, is the charioteer, driver. Mind is the rein. And the horses are the senses. Try to imagine this simile of an ancient chariot. We see the horses, we see the rein, we see the charioteer, we see the body, and we see the self which is within us, pure consciousness. If the buddhi related to a mind that is always distracted loses its discrimination, then the senses become uncontrolled, like the vicious horses of a charioteer. But if the intellect, being related to the mind that is always restrained, possesses discrimination, then the senses come under control, like the good horses of the charioteer. A man who has discrimination for his charioteer and holds the rein of the mind firmly reaches the goal, that is God. In the Keno Upanishad, the students ask the teacher, could you tell us that who directs the mind, who directs the senses? Who is guiding our desires? We like to know that person, so that we can complain, you know, if you have any problem, we can go to him that you are creating all these problems. Who is doing these things sitting inside me? We like to know. The teacher replied, Jan manusa namanute jenahur manumatam tadeva brahmatam vidhi neidam yodidam upasati. Listen, my student. Mind cannot think of that source. But the source, that Brahman, guides the mind. It is the consciousness behind the mind is functioning. That consciousness is the source. But he later told him the secret. Pratibodho viditam matam amritattam hi vindati. Atmana vindati viryam vidya vindati amritam. Pratibodho viditam. Bodhe bodh. When you really experience this Atman, in every thought you remember, I am the Atman, I am the Atman, I am the Atman, I am Brahman, I am Brahman. At that time I don't say I am Chetanananda, I am Atman, I am Chetanananda, I am Atman. Only continuous one thought will come, I am the Atman. Pratibodha, every thought way that thing comes. That is the reason sometimes I give the illustration of EKG. You see the heartbeat. If it is, the doctors know that, you know, it is irregular heartbeat or regular heartbeat. Seeing the EKG, that print, you can immediately say that what is problem in your heart. So if the thoughts are coming all the time, I am the Brahman, I am Brahman, that means you are all right. But you are thinking, I am Miss Universe, I am this, I am that. That is perhaps that time it goes to the too high. Or I am depressed, it will go down. That means you have irregular heartbeat, you see. Another thing, last night I was deeply thinking about one thing. Sometimes we say that pure mind, pure intellect, and pure Atman are the same. Sri Ramakrishna said that. How? How both all these things are same? Let me explain to you. Listen very carefully. I, want to know the Atman. I is the ego, I consciousness. No, I want to know through the mind or the intellect the Atman. So Atman is the object, and instrument is my mind, and I am the knower. Knower, knowable, and this is knowledge. That we understand. Anything you see in this world, seer, I see this chair. Through my eyes. My eyes are the instrument, this chair is the object which I want to know, and I am the knower. That we understand. But what happens? Mind cannot know the Atman, because Atman is infinite. Mind is a finite, is an instrument. This instrument, what happens, do you know, when the mind, through spiritual disciplines, when the mind becomes pure, then this Atman covers that mind. Let me give an example. There is a screen in the window. If there is a small hole through the screen, you see only outside a little. But there is no hole in the screen, there is no screen on the wall, in the window, then I see inside, outside, everything. So what happens? We veil that screen or the drapes, it becomes bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. The more you practice spiritual disciplines, all your living limitations, all your impurities go away, and it becomes a transparent mind. At that time, that light of the Atman and the light of the mind, they become one. And when they become one, the ego also become one. Which is an amazing phenomenon, this I consciousness. This real I is really the Atman, but I limited my I through my name and through my form. That is the biggest mistake we may ever make in our lives. The Swamiji was giving a lecture to some American devotees. Madam, it is a big mistake that you think that you are an American and you are a woman. Why are you limiting your infinite nature with your body and with your race, with your country? You are the Atman, you are the infinite. The way Swamiji explained these things to the American people, amazing. Why are you, madam, limiting yourself? So, finally, the ego also becomes pure. When the mind becomes pure, ego becomes pure. And then Atman, this ego, mind and Atman become unified. That is called Triputi Laya, according to Vedanta. The knower, knowledge and knowable become one. Meditator, meditation and the object of meditation become one. I sometimes watch some kids in the Laguna Beach. Do you know what do they do? The American parents carry them a small shovel, plastic shovel, and a bucket, and they go there and dig. They dig the sand, and then water, and then with a bucket they fill up their respective pools. All the children on the beach, they are playing. But when the high tide comes, all pools are filled up. So you have your small pool, I have a small pool, but when that cosmic consciousness fills up everything, it becomes one. So your eye consciousness, my own eye consciousness, all become one with that cosmic consciousness. That is the way I sometimes watch those kids on the beach and I see. They are differentiating. Hey, that is your pool. That is my pool. It is all play. How can we clean and purify the mind? One scripture, Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana, says there are four ways. Holy company. A holy person, do you know what do they do? They will remind you all the time. What is your goal? Why are you in this world? Why are you forgetting your duties? Second, Adhyatma Vidya Udhigam. I am the seer. This world is the seen. That is the practicing highest philosophy. Third, Vasana Durvasana Tyag. Give up worldly bad desires. Replace bad desires by good desires. And finally, renounce both. Fourth, Pranayama. Controlling the breath. That is the way you can purify the mind. Sometimes watch your mind. Your whole world is floating on your mind. Vidyarunya Muni mentioned how to purify the mind, how to conquer the mind in Panchadoshi, a famous Vedanta literature. Buddhau tattina dhidusha shundayina ekanta vasina dirgha pranamo charjo manorajya vijayati. Buddha tattina, in your mind, in your intellect, have a firm conviction that I am the Atman. Then remove all the dirt and pollution, impurities from the mind. Then, second stage. Third stage, go to a solitude. Go to a solitary place, go to solitude. Why? He explained why. There, you repeat pranav, om, you repeat. The commentator gave a beautiful commentary. Do you know how does it work? Here is a fort, and it is besieged by the enemies. What do they do? First they cut the supply line, so that you may not get any food and water. That way they will weaken the army inside the fort. Next, they bombard. They throw the bomb cannon shells inside the fort and kill the enemies. So the moment you go to solitude, do you know what? You cut the supply line. Of course, if you carry your television and cell phone or what is called BlackBerry, all telephone and everything in that small gadget. If you go to a solitary place with your BlackBerry, then you will find restlessness there. Then this teacher made a beautiful remark. I could not follow what matra is. Matra, how long I shall dirgha pranavam uchcharjo. You will have to repeat mantra very long way. Do you know how? He says one matra means three times. Three times the commentator says, do you know what three times? Even some musicians, they put the rhythm. That is one matra. Three times. That is one matra. So, like six matras, at that time they have no clock, they have no watches, you will have to understand. So how they make the time, that is the way they used to make it. This is the time. This is the timing I am putting to your mantra. And then repeat long. Om. In this way, a dirgha pranama uchcharjo, that way, as if at that time you are bombarding, putting shell into the mind, so that all the desires, doubts will die. You know, sometimes I see that in ancient India, how they practice these mantras and how they explode and how to conquer the minds. But if everybody conquers the mind, our economy will fail. Thomas Friedman was telling, go, buy things, so that our economy will move. If we do not buy American cars, Detroit, all these car plants will close. Many people will lose jobs. That's it. How these things are all interconnected, you know. Mind is our friend, mind is our enemy. First learn how to study the mind. Sometimes I take some mantras when I go for walk, I repeat some mantras from the Upanishads, how to deal with the mind. Paranjikhani vitrinat sambhu tasmat parang pashyanti nantaratman kashyiddhira pratyagatmana maikshat avrita jakshu amritatam ichchan. God created the mind with outgoing tendencies. So we are continuously going out to enjoy all things outside the world, outside the body, outside the mind. But there are some people, they shut the senses with a view to seeing their self, Atman within. It is a beautiful mantra from the Katha Upanishad. In Sheta Shatara Upanishad also there are this verse, this mantra also I like. Sadeha maranim kritta paramancha uttararanim dhanur nirmathanam abhyasa devam pashyet nigurabhat. By making the body, the lower piece of wood, and Om, the upper piece, and through the practice of friction, of meditation, one perceives the luminous self hidden like the fire in the wood. Then he said, when you see sesame seed, do you see an oil there? No, but oil is there. You see milk, do you see butter there? No. Churn it, you will get the butter. Then, on the seashore, sometimes we see the sandbank. We see the, do not see the water, but dig a little bit, you will see water below. Wood, do you see any fire there? No. Ignite it, you will see the fire. Similarly, this Atman, God is within us. Just you will have to churn a little bit your mind. If you churn, the mind will be pure. And in that pure mind, God will manifest. You will get peace and bliss and joy forever. That is the whole secret. Thank you.
Matma me shuddhantam jyotiraham viraja vipapma bhuyasam. Antaratma me shuddhantam jyotiraham viraja vipapma bhuyasam. Paramatma me shuddhantam jyotiraham viraja vipapma bhuyasam. May my body become pure. May I be free from impurities and ignorance. May I realize myself as the light divine. May my mind become pure. May I be free from impurities and ignorance. May I realize myself as the light divine. May my soul become pure. May I be free from impurities and ignorance. May I realize myself as the light divine. Om Shantihi, Shantihi, Shantihi. Peace, peace, peace be unto all.